Hello and welcome to the MHG podcast. Once again, but not from last week, I'm Brad and I'm joined by Stu. And I've messed up the order, so I'm just going to say the world could be a miserable place. It really, really is at the moment. I don't think I've got time to list what's going wrong with this current world, all the nastiness that's going on and everything. So we're here to bring you a bit of joy and a bit of light. So please tell me, how are you, Stu?
I'm very good. Yeah, no, I'm doing pretty well, thanks. Yeah, everything's proceeding according to plan at the moment, and you can't really ask for much more than that.
And we're having a blind date soon as
we
well.
We are. I know. Can't wait for that.
Well, it's not a blind. Well, it's a blind date.
For me, it's like that, you know, the Dream Team, where that film with Michael Keaton where he goes out with the Nutters for a day.
Oh, I love that film. It's probably like really bad, and it's probably aged terribly, but I really like that film.
I enjoyed it. It had heart.
Yeah, it's got Christopher Lloyd in it as
well. Yeah, he is, yeah.
Yes. Yes, I really like that. Yeah, I'm going to try and dig that out and watch that.
Definitely do it. But yeah, no, we're alluding to the fact we're going to the same Liverpool Women's Derby in September, which should be cool. I assume that's what you're referring to, not me like stalking around your house or vice versa.
Oh, I'll be in your other room with just my pants on, so, you know.
Oh God, I knew it.
But no, we're taking a trip up to Liverpool for the Merseyside Women's Merseyside Derby, which has been held at Anfield. And Stu's got tickets to the game, as have we.
Excellent.
And how much did your tickets cost in total? I bet it was a fortune, Stu.
It was the massive, massive price of £7 each.
We paid £16 in total for four of us.
That's fantastic.
In fact, we've got three games lined up. Up until Liverpool so far. So we're going to see West Ham at the weekend, Liverpool West Ham at the weekend in a pre-season friendly in Leicester. Don't ask. Then we're going to watch the opening game of the season, which is in Reading, at Reading's proper stadium, the Majeski, or whatever it's called these days. And then we've got the Merseyside Derby. Right. So Lucas is coming to two of those and not coming to one of them. So for 11 tickets to see three games of women's football, it's costing less than the cost of one ticket to see a men's game. That's ridiculous. Yeah.
I know. The last game that we went to, me and my wife, who are going to be coming to this one, was to watch Chester, my local team, play about 10 years ago.
Yeah.
And that was £14 each to watch Chester. Do you know what
it's
I
like
mean?
That's 25 that's quid to crazy. Watch Southend. It's like, that's Southend. With the Rose West stand. Did you see that story?
Saw about that, yeah.
where Low works, there's one of the groundskeepers for Southend works with her as well as a second job. And he was like, she went and started winding him up about it. And he just went, "Don't we all knew? We all knew what was coming." But yeah,
oh, that's good.
That's just I love it. I would have kept it personally.
Just lean into it.
I did like the, it's got like a 2,000 seat capacity and room for another 1,100 underneath.
Yeah, that one was going begging. Yeah. Zeus a good one.
Anyway, away from the joy and delight that is Fred and Rose West. Someone said, Google it
if you don't know who they are.
Someone said, right, watch Southend make the mistake of getting rid of that as a sponsor and then getting Betfred in to do it. But anyway, what else is like serial killers? Games are like serial killers. No, I don't know. It's been a week. What have you been playing, Stu?
Only one this week. A couple. I played Phase Shift, but it's not really worth talking about because you went into it in great detail.
That's the,
I didn't really.
The roll cage stroke thingy, like, isn't it? Wipeout type thing. Yeah.
Tron. Yeah. Yeah, I thought it was all right, but I don't know. I wasn't very impressed with. Yeah, I wasn't impressed with the sense of speed. It didn't really feel very fast. Unless I've missed it, I couldn't see how to change view as well. Like, you can push the view out with the stick, but you have to let. Whenever you let go of it, it goes back to default.
I'll have to play.
Ran like a dog on my computer, which is pretty powerful.
Oh, that's a shame because it wasn't running badly when I first played it. And well, I think I said about it, I said like there's a lot of work to do, but there's potential there. Is it out now or is it still early access?
It's still early access, but I think it's been in early access since 2019 or something. So, I don't know. Who knows? But anyway, that's not what I was here to talk about. I was actually going to mention Rollerdrome, which is a third-person action skating game. That's not something you get to say very often. That's done in a sort of cel-shaded style, but isn't Jet Set Radio. So it's basically you skate around and you also have to shoot people, boiling it down to its absolute smallest possible component. And it's a gorgeous looking game, looks a bit like Sable, which came out not that long ago. Yeah. It's done in that, yeah, Mobius style. The developer, there's a great developer interview that's only short but quite insightful. It's the developer is French, and he said, yeah, Mobius and Hergé were his influences. And it's really fast paced. You've got all the sorts of controls you'd expect for doing flips and tricks and all the usual kind of guff with these kinds of sports games, but it's also a bit like Murder Sport, you know, like Speedball. Yes. Sorry, my brain's terrible today because I'm overtired. So it's you have to shoot competitors at the same time, and it's got a lot of really clever ways of mixing the two. You reload your weaponry by doing tricks, and yeah, it's very, very clever. It works, and it's fun, but it for me, it misses out on being brilliant. And I'm not sure if you could get it over the line to brilliant without serious rework, because there's so many controls, and it's so difficult to keep everything in mind, especially as there's a slow-mo function for when you're shooting. So there's, you know, keeping all of your inventory of weaponry in mind, how to do the tricks, when to do them, when to evade, what sort of style you need to pull off, where you are physically in the arena, the inertia of your roller skates, the fact that you can't turn quickly, because anyone who's going on roller skates, you'll know, turning is not an easy proposition.
But you just skate forward until you go into the barrier, surely.
Basically, yeah. You go forward until you either fall on your arse, fall on your face, or hit another object. That's basically how I did it. And it replicates that sensation pretty well. So when you get into the flow, when it clicks, and it clicks like several times per match, I would say, and the matches last about 8 minutes for me, because I'm rubbish, but they're supposed to be about three. But it clicks two or three times and you're there pulling off great shots and the timing's perfect and your trick was good and you're doing it quickly at the same time. But there's also other stuff, like there's tokens around the level to collect. There's a whole thing about achieving certain milestones to progress. Now, you can tweak all of this, turn stuff on and off, so that it's not an impediment. So if you don't want to have, you have to do X number of things to get to the next level, you can turn that off. If you want invincibility, so you can just focus on, you know, your score, you can do that, etc., etc. So it's very accessible, and you can make it the game you want. I don't think it quite makes it into the brilliant camp, like I say, but it's definitely the best thing of its type, really, since Jet Set Radio Future, and it's better than a lot of those sport combat games as well.
So, one thing I still don't have a chance to play is, I know you gifted it to me, but I really thank you for that, by the way. Totally unexpected. I haven't had a chance to play it because the visuals of it strike me as I need my eyes to be a bit more healed than what they are to get anything from it, because it's got a very a pastel type effect to it, which means it needs a high contrast. We'll come to high contrast later for me possibly to get the best from it. Anyway, I thought this was a multiplayer game at its heart with a single player component. It's not, is it? It's a pure single player game, isn't it?
Yeah, certainly for the moment. There's a locked option that I can't get to that may be multiplayer, but I don't think it is. And I'm similarly thought. Like, I watched an advert for it months ago, put it on my wish list, and I thought that it had at least, I knew that it had a single player component, but I thought it was probably weighted in favour of being multiplayer. But it's actually very well constructed as a single player, certainly so far. Because it teleports in the enemies during the level, and their abilities and the timings of their shooting or dropping mines or firing rockets at you or whatever is really good. They've done it really cleverly so that you have to mix up what you do. So it's not just, okay, we're chucking in a load of bots and that's, you know, that's your single player component and really you need to go online to get the most of it. No, it's not like that at all. It's actually got a really well-tailored single player experience.
Yeah, I mean, it shouldn't shock me. Everything I've seen about it, the inertia of it all and the way you've got to do all the tricks that you said, like, it might take a little while to get used to or a long while to get used to, sort of balancing it all with the shooting mechanics or everything. But it shouldn't surprise me that it's all competent at the very least. And I won't comment on whether I think it's brilliant or anything yet because, as I say, I've not had a chance to sort of really play it. But this is from the same developers behind the Olly Olly games and Not a Hero. And the inertia and the way if it flows together in all those games they've done before are all just absolutely sublime. And Roll 7 also done a free-to-play action game called... What was it called? Laser League or something like that, which it didn't take the world by storm, but it was very, very competent at what it did, and it shows again they know how to do like arena based stuff. So I think they've got sort of like everything sort of built towards this, and from what I've seen of it and what I'm glad it seems to be more like now is it's a spiritual successor to the Jet Set Radio games mechanics. Not a spiritual successor to Jet Set Radio, but to the mechanics, which I think have never been tried properly since Jet Set Radio Future.
Yeah, yeah, it has got a good few elements of that in it. I don't trust myself with judging it a little bit because it's got a similar sort of comic style. Well, I mean, the styles of them are different, but they're both comic styled.
Yeah.
It's very easy for my brain to go straight to Jet Set Radio. And also, there are very few skating games and very few where you're doing it in skate parks. So it's hard to know, but there's got to be a big influence there. But it really does take it forward. Like, you have to... You know, the tricks, you have to really think about them and how you're blending that in. Whereas, you know, with Jet Set Radio, it kind of separates very much the traversal from the spraying part. But yeah, no, it's close enough. And it's really strange because it sounds like I've just been negative, but it's really good. It really, if you like any of that kind of motion where you know that you've got to get small directional changes right when you're going forward because you're on skates and they are very difficult to operate. If you like that and you want to challenge yourself with that, then it's really worth a go, I'd say. And it looks amazing and it's got this great, you know, 70s style. It's got an intro tune that sounds like it's from Clockwork Orange. It's got the same type of font, you know, the big chunky fonts in the 70s style bubble font, and it just, yeah, very, very reminiscent of like 70s dystopian sci-fi. So yeah, it's worth picking up.
And I've seen some of the videos, like for the intros and stuff like that, and it's got a pretty much, it's like that proper 70s 80s cartoon and anime feel. I keep getting from like the opening cartoon or the cartoons videos I've seen is like Speed Racer mixed with like other sort of 80s animes and Mask. I'm getting those sort of vibes from it. Are those sort of like anime style videos interlaced throughout the game, or is it just like promotional stuff?
I think that's just promotional. I've not seen that in the game. There's some brief first person bits when you're looking around the you know, the locker room and everything, but it's only brief, just to give you a taste of the world outside of the arenas, and it only lasts a few seconds to a minute, and then you're into the game.
I'm hoping this breeds a sequel and stuff, because the animation that you see, the promo animation, is just amazing. I want more of that.
Well, yeah, it is a lovely game. I mean, I'm those things might be in there somewhere, but irrespective, it's definitely a gorgeous thing to look at. Yeah. and runs really, really well on the deck.
Yes, that's to say, that's the thing that pretty much sold me on it, where people went, yeah, it runs well on the deck. I was like, oh, don't do this to me. I had no money. I've got a bloody backlog coming out of my arse at the moment. And I've just got like just so much to play. But yeah, as soon as my eyes are able to cope with it, I'm going to boot this one up.
Yeah, well, I'll have a look at the accessibility options as well and just see how good they are. Yeah.
Yes.
When you're,
please do. That'd be really cool.
When you're talking about your next game.
So the game I'm going to talk about to start with is one I've been sitting on for about 2 weeks now. And I've been wanting to talk about this. And that is Curse to Golf, which is a golf-based roguelike set in Purgatory. And yeah, it does what it says on the tin. It's a roguelike game with golf mechanics set in Purgatory. And you play this world-renowned golf champion who dies at the end of a championship on the 18th hole when they are about to win the golfing tournament. They are then sent down to Purgatory and get given the chance to play their way out of Purgatory and back to either heaven or to the real world. I can't remember which it is in all fairness. And you get this stereotypical Scottish ghost golfer who talks you through the mechanics and this is how you play it, and you've got a certain amount of goes to get through the entire 18 holes, otherwise you die. But because it's Purgatory, you start again because you are cursed to golf. You see, very clever.
See what they did there.
I don't think they actually say the name of the game. I like it when something does that. Always the worst when someone says the name of the game or the name of the film in the actual product that's on. But yeah, really good. Golf mechanics are nice and simple. It's gone for that traditional power bar option. Then you choose your angle. You get to add added spin mechanics. And basically you get X amount of shots to get out of each hole. But you can hit things like idols. And if you smash an idol, you get extra shots. You got some idols that are more difficult to reach and they'll give you more extra shots. Some are a bit easier, but they'll give you less shots. You get things called ace cards as well, which will give you advantages. So you could add to, you might be, I've got two really close, but I've only got one shot and I know it's going to take two. So you might have an ace card that gives you an extra shot. You can get a practice card, which will allow you to test a shot and see if it works before they're actually doing it properly. You get things to blow up. Like there's things like TNT in the way. Sometimes the TNT can be useful for you. Other times it's going to be a hindrance. So it's a card that you can use to blow it up. And obviously all your cards mixed with your golfing skills and everything, gaining the extra shots will get you to the end of the hole. And you earn money throughout. You can use that money to pay for extra cards and so on and all that stuff as well. So it's layered. What I really like about this is that it is a roguelike, but it doesn't feel as random as any other roguelike. So even the best, like your Hades, your Binding of Isaac, and Spelunkies, all games like that, it doesn't feel as random as those. I think the holes are all custom made holes. There's like 80 plus or something like that in total, but you get a random generation of which of those holes will be there. But I believe all the holes are like purpose made, so you're not going to get one that's like put it together and then you're going to get like a bullshit style area where you go, well, clearly not going to get through that even with all the help. You can, every mistake you make, you learn from. I've not got out of Purgatory yet, but I feel that I'm learning as I play. And that's a good roguelike for me, where you're not just relying on upgrades, you're relying on your knowledge of the holes. And it just plays really, really well. Really good pick up and play game. And just one thing to point out, the character in it has no gender whatsoever. Great. Referred to as they, at no point are they gendered. And nothing, no attention is brought to it at all. Just, it's the golfer.
Nice.
So fair play, well done on that.
Definitely. Excellent. Yeah. Now I've kind of had my eye on this one. I'm not like mad on golf games, but I'm not averse to them. Like if it's a good one, then I'll go for it. It's like everybody's golf is just like so peerless to me. It's just nothing else kind of comes close. But it definitely sounds like one to have a go on. Does it work well on the deck as well?
Oh god, yeah.
Cool.
Oh god, yeah. It's all I've played it on.
Nice.
It's a little bit talky at the start, I will say that. It's not just pick up, go straight in and play. There's a little bit of exposition that goes on and stuff like that. But afterwards, then, yeah, you just go through and play it. So I would set aside a good half hour or so, first time round, just to get through all the opening stuff.
Right, cool, yeah.
And you can stop at any point and it'll just save exactly where you are.
Nice. Which is good. No, I like it when you kind of know that you need to set aside, you know, a good bit of time to get into it. I mean, you know automatically with all RPGs that you need to put aside a couple of hours to when you start the game, mostly just to get to the first save point. But yeah, I like it when you find out with other games, other different types of games, that you need to put aside some time to get going. Yeah.
Yeah, because roguelikes, you don't expect it. You expect just almost just to go in and play.
Yeah.
So next up from me is a game I thought I would absolutely adore, but I've not made my mind up yet. And that's Arcade Paradise, which is from Nosebleed Interactive and is published by Wired, and it's been getting a bit of attention over the last few months. It's set in the 90s. The 90s, I would say, the aesthetics from.
Yeah.
And basically, you play this character called Ashley, who is a child of a laundrette owner who works in the laundrette, but they don't want to work in the laundrette. They want to play games and they want to build their own arcade. So guess what, you as them go and start building this arcade. And it's so you go in, you have to do all the jobs in the laundrette. Like you have to unblock the toilet, you have to load the washing machines, dry the clothes, etc, keep the rubbish picked up and everything. And do you know what, it's all well and good, and it's okay in places. But you could go in and you could like, oh, there's this one arcade machine in there, and you get to play that arcade machine, and then that's where you kind of go, oh, now I want to actually build my own arcade, and you get more arcade machines that you've got all the playable games on it. Now, the problem I've got with this game is I don't care about the story at all. I don't care about the 3D walking around life sim stuff that's going on one little bit. Just give me the games. There's like, well, I can't remember what the actual game's called, but there's like, it's a puzzle game, a match three puzzle game, and I just spent my entire time playing that. I just did not care about anything else. I went, I'll just play that. And a few of the other ones I've played, there's like 30 odd games you could choose from to play, all arcade style. And if someone has said, look, here's a mixtape of indie style games, I've at it, I would have gone, yeah, all over that. I'm all over it, but not because of the whole game in itself. I really just don't give a flying rats about most of the game. All I care about is playing the retro-inspired games. They're all based off something, for example. So you'll play a lot of them and recognise some older games that have already existed. So, you know, they are very influenced and homages and rip-offs.
Yeah.
And it's got a lovely soundtrack, and it's just an homage to the 90s era gaming. And it's, you know, don't get me wrong, the 3D side of it, the working in laundry, it's got some lovely touches. It's like, it's really well put together. You get like, you've got this like Apple Newton style PDA that you use to sort of like navigate the menus, which is a shame because I can't see it when my eyes are bad. At least have an option of a normal menu, please, developers. Yeah. If you're going to have a fancy menu, have a normal version as a backup, please. Yeah. It's all I ask with stuff like that. Another accessibility setting.
Yep.
But But I mean, I feel bad going hard on the, oh, I don't like this bit and I don't care, because so much love and attention has been put into it. And it's clear the developers care about what they've done. And it's not bad, honestly. If this was a game on its own, the Life Sim stuff, and it was just the monotony of working in a laundrette, I would have gone, do you know what? It's a really cool, good idea for a game. It works. It works as a game on its own. But when I've got that carrot of there's these cool little mini arcade games that I can play, I don't care about that stuff and I just want to play them. Yeah. So what this is missing for me, and I might, you might get it at the end and stuff like that, I don't, I've bought the game, give me the option just to have access to all the little mini games, just give me that option, because that's all I want.
Yeah.
And I know it's not your vision for the game, but for me, when you're dangling all these little bits, my ADHD brain's going, but I don't want to do that. If I was in real life, I wouldn't want to do that. I would not want to be doing like the busy work when there's an arcade machine that I can play. So in a game, I don't want to do it because I want to play the games in the game. Yeah. And it's, you know, lawn mowing simulator, power wash simulator, don't get me wrong, great. But if they put a bunch of little, like 30-odd arcade games inside those, I'd be like, well, I don't want to do the power washing. I want to go and play the power washing retro arcade game that's in the power washing game. And that's kind of the vibe I get, that there's two different ideas that don't quite come together well, but both are brilliant.
That's a really good way of expressing it. Yeah, I think there's that thing of No More Heroes where they worked out exactly what they thought was the ideal length of time to do a repetitive game, and it was like 3 minutes or something. And after that, you're totally bored. But at least there's action in that. And yeah, you can kind of jump in and jump out. But if you're going between simple games and the traversal or, you know, the open world sort of stuff, is a bit dull. That's a real dampener, isn't it? Yeah, it'd be nice if they had an option to fast forward that or skip it completely.
Yeah. Yeah. As I say, it's not dull. It works, but just not in the context of, I just want to play these games.
Yeah,
that's the only thing that's wrong with it. Honestly, it's, this is like you with Rollerdrome. I don't want to sound like I'm pissing on its chips or anything like that, because it's brilliant. All elements of this are brilliant. It's just, for me, on a personal level, and with the ADHD, I don't want the busy work in a game where I don't have to do busy work to play the little games. I put off busy work in real life to play games. So, you know. But yeah, no, it's you know, overall, it's really good, and there's a lot of value there. It just, honestly, I think it depends on what sort of person you are as to what you will get from it.
Yeah, sounds fair. Yeah, it doesn't sound like one I'd bother with. It sounds a little bit like The Lab, the VR game by Valve.
Yeah.
Which is set in Aperture Labs, and you wander around the lab, but you go and play, do individual kind of style of well, they're not all games, but they're interactive experiences. Some are games and some are less like games. But they were like, you were in this really tightly packed lab, and just literally like there's a table to one side of you, a table to the other, and go into one table, well, enter a game kind of thing. There was no, unless you really, really wanted to, there was no kind of wandering around. But it gave it a hub feel, like a, you know, a kind of anchor point for you to do it. But that wasn't really the game. So, yeah. Valve sounds like they kind of mastered the idea already on this, and maybe should have taken a page out of that book.
Yeah, I mean, I played one, if you remember, a good couple of years ago, and I'm really coming, it was like an 80s set game where it was a, like, it had a story to it, but it took you through playing loads of different retro games that you had to get through. So it'd be, one would be like a side-scrolling shooter, another was like an Outrun style game in there, but in a like a neon aesthetic, and loads of other like and the one was like an RPG that lasted about like 2 minutes and stuff.
Wasn't
that worked? Yeah.
Wasn't Not a Hero? No.
Okay. No. I just can't remember what it was called. If I find out and you want to edit in later, you can interject. But yeah, it's that worked because it was like, right, okay, look, we're just going to take you bang, bang, bang through these games with a slight story. And that worked for me. Now, I'm not saying that's what this should have been, but that took you through a reason to play them in the order that it did. Whereas this, I say, it's just got the games and I just want to play the games.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's good. It's good for what it is. The games are all good individually. I don't think there's a dud in there. Some are better than the others. I said the life stuff worked well enough. And I enjoyed that for what it was worth. But not when I've got the dangle of the games that I want to play.
Yeah, that sounds totally fair to me. Yeah.
So I've got one more. But have you got anything you want to touch on before I do my last one?
No.
Oh, no, I'm going to save this one. I'm going to save this one and do it separate. Ignore me. but I will just, before we do it, I will just say, so two I want to give a shout out to before we move on to our final discussion. One is Lost in Play, which I will do a write-up on, which is a point-and-click adventure that is just, oh, my sweet, lovely. It's brilliant. That's all I will say. Now, it's brilliant, it's brilliant, it's brilliant. Get it, play it. It's got a very much that late 2010s animation style to it, like almost Adventure Time-ish in its animation style. It's a beautiful story, loads of lovely puzzles, and just, yeah, brilliant, try it. I'll do a proper thing about that down the line. And the other one, just quickly to shout out, one of my favourite games of all time has just released on its latest system, and that is Don't Die, Mr. Robot. Has just come out on Steam. It runs perfectly on Steam Deck. It's addictive as hell and should come with a health warning because I would forget to eat and drink and breathe for that game. So good.
Do we know why it's taking so long?
And it's less than a fiver.
Do we know why it's taking so long?
I don't know. No. Don't know. Don't forget, this first came out on the Vita.
Exactly, yeah, it's ancient.
And I think it's Vita, PS4, I think there's an Xbox version, the Switch version, I don't know if there's a mobile version, but yeah, now it's come out on Steam, and it's, even though it's not verified, perfect on the Steam Deck.
Cool. Good stuff.
A game that uses no battery whatsoever, I managed to run out the battery on the Steam Deck playing it, because just one more go.
Yeah. Excellent.
I'll talk about that more down the line because I only got that last night and it's so good.
Nice.
But yeah. So, moving on, want to chat a little bit about accessibility in games because I got a chance to play Spider-Man on PC and on Steam Deck. So, just to cover, it runs really well on Steam Deck. Spider-Man is a brilliant game, always has been, still is. You might get the odd bit of slowdown, I don't notice it, I don't care. If you care about that stuff, look at a Digital Foundry or whatever. Works absolutely fine for me. But what I want to talk about is the accessibility of Spider-Man and why I think this is important and why Sony have a huge responsibility coming up. So, what Spider-Man does, and I believe it's The Last of Us does it, and a couple of other Sony games do it, is they've got loads of various accessibility options. So, some of the good ones are, do you want to skip the puzzles? Then, yeah, you can skip the puzzles. Brilliant. For people who are like the neurodiverse, ADHD, or, you know, people with other learning disabilities who might struggle with puzzles, they could just skip them. Beautiful. Well done, Sony. Well done, Insomniac. That's the right thing to do. Have them there, but give people the option to skip them. And for anyone that goes, well, that takes away from what the developers wanted and what was their true vision, you don't have to use it. And if you want to use it and can't decide, because you're getting frustrated, maybe that's not the developer's true vision. Maybe there was something wrong with that puzzle. But anyway.
Yeah.
I use that for, have you played Spider-Man?
Yeah, I haven't completed it, yeah.
Before. Do you know, like, when you do the radio towers and you've got to match up the radio waves?
I do, yeah.
But I can't see that. I can see the radio waves, one of them, but I can't see what it's meant to be matching up to. Now, don't get me wrong, I can just move the sticks about and sometimes I get it. But other times, I could be there for probably an hour if I couldn't get it, because I can't see it, or I have to get someone to help me. I could just skip it. Well done, brilliant. And I don't get punished for skipping. You've got all those like lab puzzles and stuff like that. You can skip those if you want, but complete them. Brilliant, well done. That's what's needed. Because, again, some people get frustrated at that. And because they're a neurodiverse person, they might go, well, I don't want to play the rest of the game now, if they can't skip it. So skipping it, brilliant. Loads of other little things in there that I've not used, but brilliant for other people with other disabilities. So absolutely brilliant. What's the one for me that I now want to see come to every game? And I can't, this is up to Sony or Insomniac, whoever developed this, to get this out there as a system that any developer could put into their games. And that's the high contrast mode. And what it does in Spider-Man Remastered, I don't know if it does it in the original game or anything, because I played that back when I could see properly. But in here, basically the high contrast mode is it turns all the backgrounds and all like the scenery and everything and the world into like this grayscale type thing. Spider-Man, you can make a solid colour. And all the enemies or NPCs that are relevant, different colours. You can have like yellow enemies, and you can have like green NPCs, like police are all in green. You can make like Mary Jane style characters a different colour. And basically you can see exactly where they are on the screen, where you are on the screen, and who's who, because it's solid colour on a background. You get the choice of turning it on and off by, you know, the press of a button, or you could just turn that off and have it on or off, whatever you want, so you don't accidentally do it if that's something you struggle with. Again, it might seem like a weird thing to have that as an option. You might go, oh, you just want it to be able to turn it on and off. But again, if you're someone who can use an analog stick but have, an issue with your hand, so you might have like instead of an actual hand, you might have some form of stump, and you can use the analog sticks, but you're always brushing the directional pad with a part of your hand, then you might constantly be turning it on and off, and you don't want to do that. So to have that minor option of having that option that you can turn it on and off by default, or you can turn it on and off at will, is, again, it's a lovely little touch and it's brilliant. But this high contrast mode, I looked at it and went, this should be in every game. This should be in every single game. And I couldn't think of a game where it wouldn't work. If you put it in Smash Brothers, for example, there's no reason why you couldn't have, like, your character is in this solid blue, and the other characters who are in it are in yellow, and any little supporting characters are in a different colour. The background is this grayscale. Because you still get to see on the whole, it's not flat. You still get to see like if there's a like something you need to stand on. That's not taken away. So that should be in every game. Spelunky, you could do it. There's no reason why you couldn't do it. You could make all the platforms a certain colour, the enemies a certain colour, the character a certain colour, and then grayscale the background. It can be done. Puzzle games, you could do it with that as well if you need to. Sony has shown you could do it with Spider-Man, with a massive 3D game with lots of movement. So you know you could do it for any 3D game. Why not racing games? Why not have it that you can grayscale the environment and have the racing line really show up and the cars a solid colour? Again, this is not the way the game's designed. Right, because although some people go, well, that's not how it's meant to look, it's going to take away from the artistry. Someone with a visual impairment isn't there for the artistry. They will not get the artistry because they can't. But the ability to play the game is more important than anything. And what Insomniac have done, what Sony have done with Spider-Man, and I believe, you know, especially like I think The Last of Us 2 and what they'll bring into the new Last of Us remaster. What's a second remaster called?
God knows. I don't even know what they're doing with it. It just looks like the original one to me.
But yeah, anyway, whatever that is, that's going to have all those options in it as well. Now, this is Sony's chance for some good PR and to show they are willing to play ball with the rest of the industry. If this is something you've created, make it something that can be shared to anyone. For, I would say, put it out there for free for any developer to use.
Yeah.
Or at a very, very cheap price if you want to license it out. But get it out there, because it's only good for you. Because if you turn around and say, right, more people can play games, we've made these accessibility options, more people can play games, more people are liable to then play your games because they're getting used to playing games. Because if I didn't know what I could play, like as it is, there's a couple of PlayStation games that have all these full accessibility options. Am I willing to buy a PlayStation 5 for the opportunity of maybe playing 3 or 4 games? No, I'm not. But would I be willing to buy a PlayStation 5 if I was able to play nigh on every single game that went on there? Well, of course I might. I might do that.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, that's what it is. And if you're licensing it for a small amount, you might go, I'll tell you what, instead of paying for it, you put it in and we get whatever percentage of any profits. So if all this licensing stuff works, I don't know. But whatever you do, do that. You're going to get money from all the games that use it. So do that. Do it. Get it out there. And then maybe open source it. Allow other people to build into it. Because as I've said before, right, what is good for me might not be good for someone else. And for someone who's deaf, right, I think I said, like, why don't you use the trackpads on the Steam Deck or like on the Switch, the HD Rumble stuff, to use that as a way of communicating sound. Do that. But that's not anything you can do. But someone might know how to do that or try and do that and develop it. And then it's something that can be put in everywhere. The more you bring this stuff to the fore, the more it will be developed and the better it is. It's great, great strides. And I don't want to say like we're about to have a go at Sony, because what Sony have done, what Insomniac have done, whoever the team is behind this accessibility package that they're doing, deserves all the praise they get, because it's opened up a game that I would have otherwise had to have skipped completely. So, brilliant. Well done, Sony. Well done, Insomniac. More of this, please.
Yeah, it's one of those, like you say, if it got scaled out to other platforms or to other games, that would be fantastic. I just did stick on Rollerdrome before to see about the accessibility, and there isn't really anything. There's a high contrast text mode for subtitles, but that's it. And there's hardly any subtitles in the game anyway. They barely ever appear. There's no way to change the visuals, which, you know, as you say, we're not criticising the artists or the designers or anything for that. It really is kind of like the publishers. It's kind of their responsibility to say, we'll stump up the money for a third party or for you to put these things in and make them work. And yeah, it really would be great. It really would be great, because you're narrowing your subset. Yeah, you're creating a subset of people who can play it. And even though that subset is the majority, that still doesn't make it right, you know?
Yeah. I mean, for me, I imagine when it comes to shading and sort of putting actual visuals to your wireframes and everything, you use a naming structure that's obviously not the same as, but it's a similar structure to like HTML and CSS. So like, if I wanted to, for example, go, right, I need to do high contrast stuff for this website, and I need the headers to always be like on a black background, because I need those to stand out for people with visual impairment. Or I want people to be able to turn that on. I would have a thing, right, if this button is clicked, then these elements are this background with this colour text. And the background of the site is this colour. Now, I would imagine it's a very similar thing when it comes to building a game, where you could say, right, if this element equals this grayscale, we desaturate it, take the colour out of it. If this element equals player one, for example, I don't know what they would name the wireframe for a character, but if element equals player one, everything is dark blue. That surely it's just, like, I don't want to say as simple as that, but it's along those lines, which suggests to me it could be done via a plugin where if Sony, like, or whoever does this, builds this, goes, look, here's a character silhouette plugin or a background desaturation plugin that could go, right, plug that into your game. How does it work out of the box? Might need to do some tinkering. But that would take out, surely, a lot of the work for the developers in working out how to put it in. If someone could develop a way for a plugin to put in and go, right, what's the name of your characters or your actual main elements? What are you calling these bits? And can we find a way of doing a lot of the legwork for you? I'm not saying this could be done tomorrow or even this year, but I'm saying that the development of it has to start now, so that in the next few years, that's when games are made. They look at a naming convention, the plugin goes in and does all the legwork for them.
Yeah, that would be great.
But yeah, that's all I'm going to say. That was mainly to praise Sony, to praise Spider-Man, to praise Insomniac, and it's great to see more and more accessibility settings coming in. And when it happens with a big game, it shows that there can be innovation up the top as well. It's money. It is money for them. They know that, you know, Sony have worked out that if they can get people with disabilities to play their games, they get more money. And that's what I'm okay with the corporate side doing stuff for money when it benefits everyone.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to...
Also, fuck Nintendo, by the way.
Why? What have they done now?
Oh, Ubisoft did it. Sexual abuse of their QA teams in America. Oh, so, yeah. Fuck Nintendo. Sort that one out, Bowser. Doug Bowser, obviously not.
The other Bowser. Yeah.
No. But yeah, well, yeah, because he's probably got a weird history of sexual misconduct with his kidnapping and yeah. But anyway,
we were talking about the fictional character Bowser then.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, Doug Bowser might have, who knows? Allegedly joking, not real satire. But sort that out, because, you know, I know corporations aren't good, but I don't want to put you on the Ubisoft list.
No.
You've made so many games I love, I don't want to have to go, nah, no more. Sort it out.
Yep.
Because if you don't, I will stop, you know, I will go down that line and I will say, fuck Nintendo, every time a Ubisoft game comes out, like I do with... every time a Nintendo game comes out, like I do with Ubisoft, I may be one person, but the more people that do it, the more they're going to have to start changing.
Yeah.
But anyway.
And breathe.
Yes. I overpraised the corporation too much, so obviously I had to sort that out the other way.
Yeah. It's a yin and yang kind of thing.
Yes. No, I'm not going to mention the other stuff that I've got in my head, because we said about trying to keep this one short and this would be a long rant, so no, I'm not going to say anything. So I'm going to shut up now.
No worries. Yeah, so not much to say this week other than follow us on all the socials, join our Discord if you fancy, join our Patreon because we have, you know, competitions going on at various tiers and you can win some great stuff. Check that out. And in the meantime, stay safe and stay sane.